الله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فهو المهتد، ومن يضلل فلن تجد له وليا مرشدا. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وخليله، وصلى الله عليه صلاة وسلاما يليقان بمقام سيد الأنبياء وإمام المرسلين. My dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran always in different occasions reminds us, enforces the issue, the meaning, the value of taqwa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he tells us in a clear place in the Quran, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله ولتنظر نفس ما قدمت لغد. Believers, fear Allah. Protect yourself from crossing the limits that were set by Allah. And let every soul think and reflect what you prepared for tomorrow, for the afterlife. And fear Allah, because Allah is aware of everything that you do. واتقوا الله إن الله خبير بما تعملون. Brothers and sisters, today I would like to share in these few minutes the story of the first community center in Islam, the Masjid al-Nabawi. How the early Muslims put that community together, and how the early Muslims built the Masjid al-Nabawi brick by brick, and with every stone they put together, with every clay or cement that they prepared, they were putting their hearts and souls, they were putting their ideas and dreams, they were putting their intentions in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to build a masjid that now hosts millions of people almost every day. One of the most crowded places on the face of earth after Mecca is the Masjid al-Nabawi. And while we take it for granted, because we are born, many of us are born as Muslims, and we have seen masajid and community centers around us for the majority of our lives, I want to put in perspective what was the reaction of the Sahaba towards the first masjid that they have built together. Especially for those early Muslims who converted to Islam in Mecca, who had to pray in secret. There was no adhan in Mecca, by the way. There is no salat in public. Even the name, some names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim, was very offensive to the Quraysh. For them, that was a very offensive name. They used to believe in Allah, or whatever they imagined Allah to be, but the aspect of Allah Ar-Rahman is something very offensive. And that's why Abdullah bin Mas'ud one time said, لَأُسْمِعَنَّ قُرَيْشًا الْقُرْآنَ غَدًا. I'll go and shove it in their face. I'll let them read or hear the Quran. And he was reciting Surah Ar-Rahman because this is the surah that creates the most trouble for him and for them. Ar-Rahman, عَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنَ خَلَقَ الْإِنسَانَ عَلَّمَهُ الْبَيَانَ. So, most of the Muslims would never dare to pray in public when it came to their experience in Mecca. But now, alhamdulillah, they migrated from Mecca to Medina, and they built that masjid with their own hands. It's like watching your own baby grow, and you look at those pictures, subhanallah, when they were 2 years old and they were learning to say the first few words. And there's always an argument in every house whether the first word is mama or baba. But so you see how all these memories that you have with this first masjid, those Sahaba actually were building that masjid, that community center, with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, 53 years old, carrying those stones and putting the cement together and putting that masjid together, subhanallah. And he used to recite some, not poetry, because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam did not say any poetry. وَمَا عَلَّمْنَاهُ الشِّعْرَ وَمَا يَنْبَغِي لَهُ. But he was saying some words that rhyme.
اللهم إنه لا عيش إلا عيش الآخرة فاغفر للأنصار والمهاجرة. يا الله, the only true life is the afterlife. So forgive the immigrants and the supporters of Medina. Of course, it doesn't rhyme in English. And then the Sahaba were amazed by the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the leader of the Muslim community, the most important person on earth, the guy who speaks to angels, the guy who just went to Jerusalem and then went to the seventh heaven. They saw him building the masjid with them. And they started actually saying, لَإِنْ قَعَدْنَا وَالنَّبِيُّ يَعْمَلُوا فَذَاكَ مِنَّ الْعَمَلُ الْمُضَلَّلُ. If we sit around and watch the Prophet ﷺ working, then we are in trouble basically. We should go and support the Prophet ﷺ. And he was setting the example of servant leadership. The leader who leads by example. That was the story of the first masjid. Now, where am I going with all of this? As Imam Mardini, may Allah heal him and may Allah cure him, indicated, we started putting some activities together for this masjid. And mashallah, this community is a great and awesome and very diverse masjid and community. So I want all of us to be part of this phase in the life of the masjid where we build the hearts and minds of the people of this community. Alhamdulillah, we are starting from a strong foundation. We are not starting from scratch. And I want all of us to put in our, to draw in our heads the picture, the image of the Masjid al-Nabawi. How the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and how the Sahaba built that community. And how all of them were not spectators, were not audience, were not people who just come and pray and leave. Most of them took ownership in the Masjid. This is my Masjid. I'll do my best. I will put my heart into this masjid to make it a successful journey. A lot of beautiful stories on how the Sahaba took ownership of the masjid, starting with the story of the Adhan. So after they built the masjid, and there's the 5 daily prayers, they wanted a way, they were brainstorming a way to call the people to prayer. And some suggested that they use a horn, you know, like what the Jews do. They said, no, we want something for us, for Muslims. We want our own identity as Muslims. Why don't we use ring a bell? No, this is for Christians. We wanted a way to call the people to prayer that's unique for Muslims, that shows our identity, that's creative. And subhanAllah, the story of the Adhan did not involve a revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, direct revelation. Of course, there was Iqrar. The Prophet approved the method. But the method started with a Sahabi seeing a dream. Abdullah ibn Zayd. Not one of the VIPs of the Sahaba. Not a strong scholar. Not a very amazing warrior in the battlefield. Humble Sahabi. The only story he has, significant story, is the story of the Adhan. He saw a dream. And usually when you see a dream, this indicates that, of course, it's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but this indicates that you are thinking about it. That when he went back home after that meeting, when they were brainstorming, how can we call for the Adhan, he got obsessed with the idea. I want to be part of this masjid. I want to be part of this community. And he saw a dream, somebody calling for prayer. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Exactly the wording of the Adhan. And by the way, one of the ways to identify a dream from random visions in your sleep is that you remember vividly what you saw in the dream. You remember the words, you remember places, faces, you remember all of that. And I know the dream issue is a very complex concept. We love to talk about dreams, mainly because we try to escape from our reality as Muslims. But that Sahabi, his dream was an inspiration for him to fix his reality. So he saw that dream and went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and narrated what he saw. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam approved. He said, yes, we can use this in the prayer, to call for prayer. Umar bin Khattab came and he saw somebody raising the Adhan. It was like, Ya Rasulullah, I saw the same dream.
Subhanallah.
So two companions saw the same dream, but Abdullah bin Zayd was there first. What's very interesting is that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam did not give the owner of the idea, although it doesn't belong to anyone, he did not give him the responsibility to raise the adhan. And Abdullah bin Zayd could have said, Ya Rasulullah, it's my idea, my dream, it's my project, why shouldn't I do it? He said a very profound, interesting statement. Wallahi, if we want to learn leadership, we learn it from Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Before we learn it from other CEOs and other, you know, cool titles and books, it's not wrong to learn from other people. But let's learn from Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, Mur Bilalan fa'innahu anda minka sawtan. Ask Bilal to be the one to call for the prayer because he has a louder voice, he has a more beautiful voice. So he asked Bilal, who is an ex-slave, a man with a dark skin, a minority in our terms, but he had a talent. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam put his talent to good use. Brothers, can we come to the front? Mur Bilalan fa'innahu anda minka sawtan. And from that day on, Bilal bin Rabah became the main muadhin for the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and for the Muslim community. The second muadhin, the second person to call for prayer, was Abdullah bin Ummi Maktoum, a blind man. And you can think about it for a second. There was no Apple Watch to tell you the time for the salah. The muadhin technically has to look at the sun in the middle of the horizon, and then for Asr time, then Maghrib time. He needed someone else to tell him, hey, Abdullah, this is time for Salat. Go and raise the Adhan. So technically, with Abdullah, it was two people assigned to perform the task of checking the time for Salat and calling for the Adhan. And someone from a corporate environment, and I'm not picking on corporate people because I'm one of them, might talk about corporate efficiency. Where is the fitness in this? Two people for one job? Why do this? Why not assign one person and let Abdullah ibn Maktoum live on welfare? That's not the leadership of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because every single Muslim has a role in building this community. Every believer, every man, every woman should be part of building this dream. This is what made that first Muslim community strong. This is what made them connected to each other. Muslims were not spectators. They were not audience. They were not students. They were active community members who worked together, and they built that masjid with their minds and hearts and efforts, and they defended this masjid, and they contributed to this masjid. Brothers and sisters, I am honored that I am part of this beautiful community. And I know many people in the audience, both men and women, fathers, mothers, parents, grandparents, youth, and together, inshallah ta'ala, we can make an amazing model community for Muslims in Michigan and in the whole United States. But we have to put that vision of the first masjid that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has built. Maybe the adhan, maybe it requires a khutbah by itself, just the meaning of the adhan, and the stories of how the Muslims used to give their minds and hearts for the masjid. A sahabi with the name Tamim Ad-Dari. It's a weak story, but people narrated for the Ibrah. Tamim Ad-Dari, who came to Medina from Syria, and he had a business. He had new ways to, you know, for kerosene lamps, and he had oil, and he had all kinds of lighting equipment. And one time the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam entered the Masjid of Salat al-Maghrib, and he saw that Tamim Ad-Dari actually brought those kerosene lamps, put the oil in them, and he actually lit the whole masjid. The masjid was literally lit. And the Prophet ﷺ was amazed by the scene, was amazed by this new ideas and innovation and creativity being put in the masjid of the Prophet ﷺ. So he told him, نورت الإسلام, you gave light to this religion. نور الله عليك في الدنيا والآخرة, may Allah enlighten your word and your hereafter. And he then told him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if I had another daughter who is not married, would have married my daughter to you, Ya Tamim. Allahu Akbar. You would have become the son-in-law of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For that idea, for that obsession of helping the masajid, the community centers, and bringing your innovation and your creativity to the masjid. At that point, a man from Banu Hashim, from the cousins of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Nawfal ibn al-Harith ibn Abd al-Muttalib, he said, Ya Rasulullah, I have a daughter, and I will marry my daughter to Tamim. And he actually became engaged and then married to the daughter, who is actually an extended cousin of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the Prophet hooked him up with a beautiful, righteous marriage. Again, the idea, we are one community. We work together. My favorite story about being part of the masjid and being part of the community is that of a slave lady who used to be a slave. She's a woman with a dark skin. Some narration mentioned her name is Umm Mihjan or Mihjana. So that woman used to clean the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. امرأة كانت تلتقط الخرق والعيدان من المسجد. She would go and pick up the garbage and make sure that the masjid is spotless. That was her contribution. I'm good at it. I am, you know, some, mashallah, some sisters are OCD. They want everything to be straight. That was that lady, mashallah. And she always kept the masjid on point, mashallah. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, she became sick. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam visited her. And apparently she's getting sicker and sicker, and she may pass away anytime. And the Prophet ﷺ told them, if she passes away, no matter what the time is, tell me, I'll go and bury her myself, make dua for her, and pray on her. She passed away in the night. And ikram al-mayyit dafnu, if you want to honor the deceased, just go rush into the funeral. And the Prophet ﷺ woke up in the morning, where's that lady? She passed away, and we buried her. Why didn't you tell me? Ya Rasulullah, you were asleep. And why would we bother you for a woman? No, Prophet. No, that's not how the Prophet ﷺ perceived. Every community member, every person is important. No matter how we label them as minorities or people of lower class or not elitist. No, everyone is important. Prophet ﷺ went to her grave and prayed for her and made dua for her. Brothers and sisters, when it comes to the masajid, the community centers, we should take ownership. We are partners in this masjid. We are not spectators. We are not audience. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us and empower us and put barakah in our efforts so that inshallah we make this masjid and every other masjid in our area a masjid like the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a community center, a home, not a house, a place where people can relate to and can connect to Allah too. وأسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى to help us with all of this. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله العظيم لي ولكم فاستغفروه فيا فوز المستغفرين. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Brothers and sisters, when we come about to building the masjid, the community center that all of us want and strive for, the number one requirement in engineering terms, it's not the building. It's not how clean or how fancy or how spotless it is. It's about making sure that it's a safe zone for everyone. I always talk about that young man who came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, taking permission to commit zina, adultery, fornication. Of course, we're not endorsing him, but the idea that the Prophet ﷺ created a safe environment for him to come and share his story and feel that, hey, if I need a question, if I have to resort to someone, I have none but the masjid, I have none but the imam, I have none but the messenger ﷺ. So creating that environment was not the task of the messenger of Allah himself alone. It was everyone who makes sure that this masjid is inclusive. So alhamdulillah, we are putting together a lot of events for the youth, for the family, and for sisters in particular, because wallahi, there is no masjid that can be put together without women, without sisters, without them who technically they are half of the community, and actually they raise the other half, and they influence and empower the other half, so they are almost the whole community. So we have youth events, inshallah ta'ala, that will be announced after the salat with Brother Muhammad Kazbour. We have signing sheet on the brother's side and women and sister's side. Please sign up so that you are informed. Let us know what events you want to be part of, whether it's youth, whether it's family, whether it's the outreach and da'wah, or whether it's for the women's activities. You are a partner. You are not a spectator. Try to spread the word so that other people will know about this. We already started with private Arabic classes for those who want to teach, to learn the Arabic language, whether you are a beginner level or an advanced level with our Sheikh, Sheikh Qasim. And we already, women's classes already started. As an action item, I wanted to take one step. In the next week or weeks, try to schedule one occasion where you come to the masjid outside of Salat al-Jum'ah. So alhamdulillah, we are consistent. Come here, and mashallah, this masjid is crowded. Somebody was telling me that maybe we need two Jum'ahs or we need to expand. I told him maybe we are limited in space, but imagine what's gonna happen if each one of us plans to come one extra time to the masjid outside of Salat al-Jum'ah, whether it's Friday night, Saturday night, anytime. Whether we have an event or you're here just to socialize or to connect to Allah or to read some Quran. Imagine how the community will be put together. In Islam, the foundation is the masjid. The backbone of the community is the masjid. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us revive this masjid and this community and every other community, inshallah ta'ala. Allahumma aghfir lana dhunubana wa israfana fi amrina wa thabbit aqdamina wa ansurna ala qawm al-kafirin. Allahumma ahdina wa ahdibina wa ja'alna sababan liman ihtada wa ahdin nasa ala aydina. Allahumma ja'alna hudatan mahdiyin ghayra dhalina wala mudillin, silman li awliyaik, harban ala a'daik. نحب بحبك من أحبك ونعادي بعداوتك من خالفك يا رب العالمين ويا أرحم الراحمين. وصل اللهم وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. وأقم الصلاة إن الصلاة تنهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر.